Good afternoon, book lovers. I'm trying a little something new this time. For the first time ever, I'm working from a script. My hope is that my thoughts will therefore be a little bit more organized. If you're watching this on YouTube, please consider giving it a thumbs up and subscribing to these videos. Also, I have a link to my Patreon page in the description if you want to support my work. Art and Revolution is a 1969 book by English critic John Berger, who lived from 1926 to 2017. Berger is probably best known for his 1972 book, Ways of Seeing. The subject of Art and Revolution is Russian sculptor Ernst Neizvestny, born in 1925 and died in 2016, almost an exact contemporary of Berger. He was a paratrooper who was seriously injured during World War II and took up sculpture after the war. To give us the necessary background to continue, Berger provides a brief history of Russian art. The Russian Academy was created by Peter the Great as part of his modernizing program. It was modeled after the French Academy. The serfs were freed in 1861, and 2 years later, there was a revolt against the Russian Academy. 13 students were expelled for protesting an Academy gold medal winner for its unslavic content. They ended up calling themselves the Wanderers. The best known of them, in the West at least, was Ilya Repin. His best known painting is Barge Haulers on the Volga, painted between 1870 and 1873. Berger criticizes the Wanderers for retaining academic techniques. Their subject matter changed, but their means of painting did not. I think he is clearly thinking about the revolutionary techniques of their contemporaries in France, the Impressionists. Russian artists in the early 20th century were clearly influenced by French and Italian modernists, imported by far-sighted collectors like Sergei Shukin. Modernist painting arrives in Russia about 1910. Its proponents include such great artists as Kazimir Malevich, Elazitsky, Alexander Rodchenko, Vladimir Tatlin, and many others. Many of them were enthusiastic supporters of the Russian Revolution and continued to innovate after the revolution had occurred. However, by 1931, Soviet art was under the centralized control of the Union of Artists, led by Isaac Brodsky, who had been a student of Ilya Repin's. The portrait of Stalin here is from 1933. The formation of the Union of Artists was followed in 1932 by the promulgation of socialist realism as the official art style of the Soviet Union. Socialist realism was strongly influenced by the Wanderers. There were two bureaucracies that established and policed Soviet visual art. The Academy of Fine Arts was smaller than the Union of Artists, which represented all professional artists. There was antagonism between the Academy of Fine Arts and the Union of Artists. The Academy was considered more conservative, the Union more liberal, but the actual difference was very slight, and they both hated modernist experimentation, which was viewed as nihilistic and cosmopolitan, both of which were serious no-nos in the Soviet Union. In the 1930s and 40s, any artist who wished to experiment with unofficial techniques had to do it privately. Berger writes, "They challenged the Academy, but their challenge was a quietist one of non-cooperation. Had it been more open, they certainly would have been destroyed." Ernst Neizvestny worked in a tiny disused shop in Moscow. He installed a very small foundry in the back in which he could cast only small pieces. If he wanted to make anything larger, he would have to cast it in pieces and then assemble the pieces separately. The photos of the pieces I'm showing you are presumably quite small, but are never shown in the book in context with their surroundings, so we don't have a clear idea of their scale. All the photos of Neizvestny's sculptures are by John Moore, except for the photos of the Khrushchev Memorial, which I'll show you later. These were printed in Art and Revolution, and the quality of the reproduction is not great, and when scanned, often had moiré patterns, for which I apologize. Neizvestny's entry into a contest for a victory monument in Moscow was awarded to him by the generals judging the contest but the award was vetoed by the Academy of Fine Arts. It was therefore never built. The Union of Artists organized a show in Moscow in the early 60s with the intent of thumbing their nose at the more conservative Academy. The exhibition was held under the auspices of the Moscow city government and included a section of unofficial artists. Unofficial artists were artists like Neizvestny who were not members of the Union of Artists. In a sense, it meant that they were amateurs and that they didn't make a living from their art. This was not always true. Ilya Kabakov, who produced art in the Soviet Union in the 70s and 80s and is still working and is one of Russia's greatest artists, belonged to the Union of Artists. His day job was producing illustrations for children's books, while his unofficial art was some of the Soviet Union's first conceptual art. This piece, Heads, from 1968, shows clearly how he used the skills of his official work in producing unofficial artwork. When the exhibit was closed, they moved it to the Manege building right next to the Kremlin. The intent was to let the government see this unofficial art and decide what to do about it. I'm going to read a section from the book about this exhibit. The exhibition opened and caused a sensation, partly as a result of the works exhibited, which were unlike any work seen in the public for at least 20 years, even more as a result of the enthusiasm with which the younger generation greeted them. The crowds and queues were beyond anybody's expectations. After a few days, the exhibition was officially closed down, and the artists were told that they must bring their work to the Manege building by the side of the Kremlin. So the problems raised by the work could be considered by the government and the Central Committee. Okay, I'm skipping ahead here. Bill Yudin, who is one of the organizers, suggested to the artists that they should leave their more extreme works behind and only take the more conventional ones. Neizvestny opposed this on the grounds that it would deceive nobody, also because here was an opportunity for having at least the existence of their work officially recognized. The artists hung their work in the Manege building. Several of them worked throughout the night. Then they waited. The building was cordoned off by security men. The gallery searched, windows and curtains checked. The entourage of about 70 men entered the building. Khrushchev had no sooner reached the top of the stairs than he began to shout, "Dog shit! Filth! Disgrace! Who is responsible for this? Who is the leader?" A man stepped forward. "Who are you?" The voice of the man was scarcely audible. "Bill Yudin," he said. "Who?" shouted Khrushchev. Someone in the government ranks said, "He's not the real leader. You don't want him. That's the real leader," and pointed to Neizvestny. Khrushchev began to shout again, but this time Neizvestny shouted back, "You may be premier and chairman, but not here in front of my works. Here I am premier, and we shall discuss as equals." To many of his friends, this reply of Neizvestny seemed more dangerous than Khrushchev's anger. A minister by the side of Khrushchev, "Who are you talking to? This is not prime minister. As for you, we are going to have you sent to the uranium mines." Two security men seized Neizvestny's arms. He ignored the minister and spoke straight to Khrushchev. "They are both short men of about equal height. You are talking to a man who is perfectly capable of killing himself at any moment. Your threats mean nothing to me." The formality of the statement made it entirely convincing. At a sign from the same person in the entourage who had instructed the security men to seize Neizvestny's arms, they now released them. Feeling his arms freed, Neizvestny slowly turned his back and began walking towards his work. For a moment, nobody moved. He knew that for the second time in his life, he was very near to being lost. First time being, I guess, when he was injured in World War II. What happened next would be decisive. He continued walking, straining his ears. The artists and onlookers were absolutely silent, but at least he heard the heavy, slow breathing behind him. Khrushchev was following. The two men began to argue about the works on view, often raising their voices. Neizvestny was frequently interrupted by those who had by now reassembled around the Prime Minister. The head of the security police. Look at that coat you're wearing. It's a beatnik coat, Neizvestny. I have been working all night preparing this exhibition. Your men wouldn't allow my wife in this morning to bring me a clean shirt. You should be ashamed of yourself in a society which honors labor to make such a remark. When Neizvestny referred to the work of his artist friends, he was accused of being a homosexual. He replied again by speaking directly to Khrushchev. In such matters, Nikita Sergeyevich, it is awkward to bear testimony on one's own behalf. But if you find a girl here and now, I think I should be able to show you. Khrushchev laughed. Then on the next occasion, when Neizvestny contradicted him, he suddenly demanded, "Where do you get your bronze from, Neizvestny?" "I steal it." Minister. "He's mixed up in the black market and other rackets, too." Neizvestny. "These are very grave charges made by a government head, and I demand the fullest possible investigation. Pending the results of this investigation, I should like to say, I do not steal in the way that has been implied. The material I use is scrap, but in order to go on working at it, I have to come by it illegally." Gradually, the talk between the two men became less tense, and the subject was no longer exclusively the work on view. Khrushchev, "What do you think of the art produced under Stalin?" Neizvestny, "I think it was rotten, and the same kind of artists are deceiving you." Khrushchev, "The methods that Stalin used were wrong, but the art was not." Neizvestny, "I do not know how, as Marxists, we can think like that. The methods Stalin used served the cult of personality, and this became the content of the art he allowed. Therefore, the art was rotten, too." So it went on for about an hour. The room was very hot. Everyone had to remain standing. The tension was high. One or two people had fainted. Yet nobody dared interrupt Khrushchev. The dialogue could only be brought to a close via Neizvestny. "Gotta wind it up now," he heard somebody in the government ranks say from behind his ear. Obediently, he held his hand out to Khrushchev and said, "Perhaps we should stop now." The entourage moved across the doorway to the staircase. Khrushchev turned around. "You're the kind of man I like. There's an angel and a devil in you," he said. "If the angel wins, we can get along together. If the devil wins, we shall destroy you." Neizvestny left the building expected to be arrested before he reached the corner of Gorky Street. He was not arrested. I love that story. And I think I would love to read a transcript of the entire dialogue. I think it would be a good play. Anyway, this incident has also been described somewhat more pungently than in Berger's version in the biography of Khrushchev, the man in his era. Neizvestny never suffered official consequences for his face-off with Khrushchev, a striking difference between Khrushchev and Stalin. Khrushchev was deposed in a coup in 1964 and died in 1971. It took 4 years after his death for his family to get permission to erect a monument at his grave. Amazingly, the job of designing and sculpting it was given to Neizvestny. Neizvestny sculpted a fairly realistic portrait bust of Khrushchev set inside a modernist geometric setting. The photos I'm showing to you come from John Friedman's blog, Russian Culture and Landmarks. Neizvestny never got an official government commission until 1966 when he entered a competition anonymously. He immigrated to the U.S. in 1976, long after Berger's book was written. I'd love to know what the circumstances were, but I've never found out. Neizvestny's work obviously does not fit into the timeline of art in the West. It's totally unrelated to the sculpture of his Western contemporaries like Anthony Cairo, David Smith, Louise Nevelson, Mark Isabero, Donald Judd, Jean Tingley, Ruth Asawa, and so forth. Berger suggests his work is closer in style to many artists who worked during and just after World War I, like Jacques Lipchitz, Osip Zadkine, Pablo Gargallo, Henri Gaudier-Bresca, Jacob Epstein, and Raymond Duchamp-Villon, one of Marcel Duchamp's brothers. The only later artist of note who seems to share stylistic qualities with Neizvestny is Henry Moore, but Moore was already well established by the time Neizvestny started sculpting. This suggests that because the Russian art scene was so isolated, it didn't really progress like modernism did in the West. Berger rejects this idea because he sees some of Russia's other unofficial artists influenced by contemporary Western art styles, but it seems basically plausible to me. Neizvestny developed his own style because there was no trend for him to follow, except the trend of socialist realism, which he utterly rejected. And that's it. Thanks very much. I hope you enjoyed it.